Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm going to try to show you what link time optimization or interprocedural optimization, also known as LTO and IPO, can actually give you and why they can have a huge performance benefit in your code. Okay, so I've set up a somewhat realistic example here, and please bear with me. I am using a relatively new feature of Compiler Explorer that lets you set up an entire project for your code base. So this might take a little bit of getting used to navigate everything here, but I have this project set up. That is a CMake project in Compiler Explorer. And I've got a handful of files. Now, I am actually creating three different C++ files, and this is intentional because I need to separate them in more kind of a real-world scenario that you might see in your actual code. So I've got this declarations header file, and I'm just declaring a single function. It's called add. It adds two numbers, and it returns the result. And then in my implementation file, I have this add function, and it looks exactly like we would expect it to. It adds two numbers and returns the result. Then in file one, I've got some function called getValue. And in file two, I've just got this function called getValue2. So I've got just multiple ways of calling this same thing. And we can see here that getValue2 is being called from main, and it calls the add function, which has an add, which has an add. And really, we're just adding x plus y plus z here. This should be pretty straightforward. And we have the values known at compile time. So that should be 1 plus 1 plus 2 plus 3, which should be 7. But if we look at our fully optimized build output that I have here with a -03 compilation, and I look at main, I can see that main is actually calling getValue2. And in getValue2, I am calling add, I am calling add, I am calling add. And this becomes a surprisingly expensive function to call. And in fact, if we look at the other simple getValue function, it is having to call add as well. And that effectively is because we have declared these things in different translation units. They're in different CPP files. So the compiler links these things together, and we can actually look at this a little bit. Okay, so I have here disassembled the file1.cpp.o. Now, it's not giving me the actual name of the function that it's calling here. It's giving me like a placeholder, and it's saying from your link table, I want you to call this getValue function. We don't get full visibility into what exactly is happening here, but we know that getValue is jumping to the function add. And if I switch over to file two, then we can see that we're getting add called three times, which is exactly what we told it to do. And, you know, this is probably a little bit frustrating when you look at it from this very simple perspective, but we gave it three different CVP files. It compiles them separately. It links them together. It has no way of doing cross CVP file optimizations here. Well, it doesn't by default. And that's where interprocedural optimization or link time optimization comes into play. So we actually have this feature, and you can see it's currently commented out from CMake called check IPO supported. So they're referring to it by this interprocedural optimization name here. And I have checked to see if it's supported and everything. And then I have the option here to say for the target called test, I want you to enable the property called interprocedural optimization. I want you to set this to true. Now, I meant to start this video by saying this is not going to be a very technical, in-depth view of what IPO actually does. This is an overview of what it can give you. So we see here that we simply can't inline this very, very simple function call. Now, when I uncomment the set property line, we're going to get interprocedural optimization in our code. What's going to happen is the compiler is actually not going to compile three separate object files in the traditional sense anymore. It's going to make an intermediate representation of each of these object files. And then at link time is when it's going to actually generate our x86 code that we would want to execute. So the end result is that I'm not really going to be able to see so much. And you can see here four lines filtered from this file 2.cvp.0. And there's just simply nothing for it to tell us. But I can go back to what I had originally, which was the binary. We can disassemble the binary. And I can now see that main simply returns 7. That's what we knew the value should have been all along. And since we did interprocedural optimization and we have this O3 build, we're not even seeing the rest of the functions right now. That's it. Our entire program becomes return 7 from main, which again is really what we wanted to see in the first place. And just so you know, so if I throw in an unknown here, the compiler is still going to do all of its normal magic that it can do. And now it says, take this first parameter, whatever argc is, and add 5 to it. So it knows that that was 1 plus 1 is 2 plus 3 is 5 plus whatever argc happened to be is going to be the return value for main now. So that, in a very small nutshell, is what interprocedural optimization can give you. And it's going to be a trade-off. You're going to get probably faster compile times because the optimizer doesn't run on each .o file. And then you're going to get probably slower link times because now it has to try to find all of the optimizations that can go across function call boundaries and then do the full optimization that needs to occur to actually generate your binary. So yeah, I hope this episode of C++ Weekly was interesting. We will be using this concept again very soon in an upcoming episode, so I really wanted to explain the concept here first so that we could take advantage of it in a follow-up episode. Make sure you subscribe.